So in this episode of Mind Pump, we talk about the five must-do things that people over the age of 40 should do when they pursue fitness and health through exercise and nutrition. Now, this episode is also extremely valuable for those of you who are trainers. This is very valuable information for you, for your clients. And of course, if you yourself are over 40, you will not want to miss this. Now, we talk about all the challenges that come with being over 40. We also talk about all of the pluses that you have. That's right. There are advantages to being over 40 as well. And then, of course, we go over the five most important things you should focus on, and we give you specific recommendations. You are going to enjoy this episode. Also, all month long, MAPS Split and the MAPS Split t-shirt. So the program and the t-shirt are both 50% off. Now, the program is a full workout routine. It is a split-based bodybuilder-inspired routine, so it's really, really great for people who want to build muscle, people who want to sculpt and shape their bodies, people who really want to develop their bodies and who like to work out. This is a six-day-a-week routine. It's advanced, and again, it's very popular. It's half off. Here's how you get the discount. Go to mapssplit.com. That's mapssplit.com, and use the code SPLIT50. That's SPLIT50, no space, for the discount.
So I have something for you guys.
Oh, good.
Now, because we had both you guys' birthdays recently.
Yeah.
I'm a recent 40-year-old.
And you are. I am still under. So I still got a year to train like an asshole.
Wait a minute. How old are you right now?
38.
Oh, okay.
See, that's
you turned 39 this year?
Yeah, I'm 39 this year.
And then you turn 40, yes. Finally.
That's normally what comes after 39.
That's right. Yeah.
So
I'm good at math.
I've got a little over a year and a half to make more mistakes, still do stupid stuff when I train, but I want to get mentally prepared for when the 4-0 hits.
Mm-hmm.
How do I need to train different? And that's a question I get in DMs all the time.
All the time.
Right.
All the time. And to be honest, and I think we are probably really, really good people to comment on this, and I'll tell you why.
Because we're over 40?
Well, besides that, that's what qualifies
us.
We're in
the demographic.
But here's the deal. You hear a lot about the challenges of working out over 40, but a lot of times you hear that coming from people who are not maintaining their fitness their whole time.
Yeah.
So then they come in, they try to work out, and I try to explain to them, most of the challenges you're experiencing have more to do with the fact that you just haven't worked out.
Right, right.
And less to do with your age. All of us have been consistent for decades. I've been doing it since I was 14 consistently. I mean, besides injuries, I never stopped.
Mm-hmm.
But there are, and it started happening not at 40, by the way. I started noticing at about 35, 36. Once I went on the back half of 30, I did started to notice some differences in the way I recover, my body, and that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then it started to make sense to me. Like, okay, now I understand why this is a category, you know, training over 40 versus training under 40.
I used to make fun of my dad all the time because he'd like lube himself up with this Bengay and all this other stuff. That sounded really bad, but but he was just trying to get his joints to you know, respond. And even before we'd play just a regular pickup game of basketball,
he
just
greased his whole body.
He greases his whole body up. And I'm like, oh my God, is this really necessary? And now I'm starting to see, you know, like why he did that. And it's really just the prep before you go to do any kind of like real rigorous type of activity, any kind of like heavy lifting.
Yeah. Oh, you can almost guarantee at 5:30 a.m. in 24-hour fitness locker room, you will always smell Bengay. I mean, that's when all. If you're at
Tiger Balm,
if you're in the gym at 5:30 in the morning, more likely that you're a businessman or woman there, and you're working out, you're consistent and stuff like that, and you're probably north of 40 years old, and you can pretty much guarantee that the entire, you know, men's locker room smells like Bengay at 5:30 in the morning.
It's totally true. Here's the biggest thing that I noticed, and again, I think we're good people to talk about this because we've already isolated out like the changes that we felt are had to do with our age, not the fact that we stopped working out. Okay, here's the biggest thing that I noticed: recovery, or to be more specific, I can't get away with stupid stuff like I used to. That's what I like. I like to be a little bit more specific because I still have good recovery so long as I train appropriately. When I was younger, in my 20s and early 30s, my recovery was better for when I did stupid stuff. So if I went, I'll never forget this. I turned 30, and for my birthday, I had this wonderful idea that I would go in the gym, I'd put 315 on the bar, and I would do 10 reps of deadlifts, and I'd rest for 30 seconds and do 10 sets. I thought, this is, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do for 30, total 30, you know, 10 times three, right? So, and it destroyed me. I was so sore, and so it was just insane. There was no rhyme or reason behind it. It was just me turning 30 thinking, oh, this is going to be a cool thing to do. But I was okay with that. Today, I could still do the same thing. I would not be able to recover like I did when I was 30 from something like that.
I think let's talk about why that is though, right? I think there's several variables that that play a role in why that is. Like, at least for me, things that I've noticed as I've aged, you know, I move less. I move way less today than when I did 10 years ago.
That's a big factor.
Right. And when you think about recovery, just facilitating movement, more oxygen, more blood, more nutrients through circulating through the body, I think that it's less to do with I'm 40 versus and I was 25 then, and it's more to do, hey, at 25, I was extremely active all the time, and what that promotes for recovery. Because I'm a lot less active, I also have to eat significantly lower to match my lower activity.
And it is easier to recover when your calories are higher, exactly. Even if you're burning it through activity.
Right, because you're giving yourself all those nutrients that I'm probably lacking more often now than what I was when I was consuming 4,000 plus mm-hmm. calories. And then that movie. So I think that has a lot to play with it.
That's actually a great point. There's another one too, and that's that when you're 40, you have 40 years of potential cumulative things that have happened to your body. So, you know, at 20, I might not have had any injuries I've had to rehab, but at 40, I might have had a few to rehab. Now, I might be rehabbed from them, but they start to add up a little bit, and that can also contribute to the changes in recovery.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Plus, you might have built some compensatory patterns, you know, that aren't as favorable as they used to be.
Right, right. Now, of course, age by itself, everything else being equal, age by itself also does play a factor. Of course, the body does age and over time starts to, you know, you're born and then you get older and then it goes kind of backwards. Like it's time now to, at some point you go back to where you came from. And so there's that process that happens. Of course, 40 is you're still very young, but the 40-year-old body, there are some differences due to age that maybe don't see as often as when you're 20 or 30. And those can also play a role. They really can. Here's the other one, though, that plays a big... And now, besides that, there's other factors, like what Adam said, like what I said with the potential accumulation of injuries. And then there's also this. It's a much more stressful, hectic life. When you're 40, does that play a role in recovery? I think so. Absolutely. You know, when you're 20-something years old and you don't have kids, you don't have much to worry about. You worry about eating, going to the gym, and, you know, whatever. When you're 40, worrying about your mortgage and your kids and meetings and business and all
lots
that other stuff.
Lots more responsibilities.
Yeah. And does that play a role in your ability to recover? I think it does.
I think so. I think it's important to note, too, because there's some 22-year-old that's screaming, going like, I have a mortgage and I'm going through college and I have a kid, right? So there's always exceptions to the rule
of
somebody who may be taking on more. But generally speaking, you know, as you start to get up in your 40s, you're more than likely married, a kid or multiple kids, a mortgage, a job, in and out. And the stress of that absolutely is going to take a toll. It's going to take a toll on your rest, and we know how important rest is for recovery. We addressed this the other day in the podcast, talking about those. You don't think about things like that, like just your mind being distracted and everything like that, like what a low level consistent stress that is, and just never allowing the body to get over into that parasympathetic state.
Yeah, right? And it's less of the, think of it this way, because I've been thinking about this a lot. It's, forget the fact that it's this low level stress that you're having all the time. It's the lack of break from it.
Right.
Is really what it is.
Yeah.
Is the lack of
getting out of that state.
Yeah. No distraction. No, you know, you're just with yourself. And you know, being at our age, we know the difference between the two, because we live two lives. If you really think about it, we live the pre-super distracted, you know, technology life growing up, and then the post one. I mean, you know, in my 20s, I didn't have cell phones like we have now until, you know, mid to late 20s. Before that, the cell phone was just your regular, you just call somebody or whatever and couldn't do anything else. So all those breaks were like waiting in lines, you know, going to the bathroom, sitting in your car, You don't realize that those make a difference. And we don't have those.
It's crazy too. Like you kind of mentioned sleep. I just remember being able to sleep anywhere, you know, when I was in my 20s and then even like early 30s and I was fine. Like I could sleep on a couch. I could sleep for me. If I don't get good sleep, it really affects the whole rest of my week. It takes days for me to get that back. That's one thing I've noticed. If I'm not really like adamant about like getting proper rest, like it really screws me over.
Sal still has this gift.
I don't know how you do it.
Yeah.
Before the plane,
it's a superpower.
It is a superpower, dude.
Yeah. No, but you're right. It's quite common. It might have a lot more to do with the stress and schedule than it does to related to age. You know, when you're like again,
sure.
When you're sure, you could be stressed out in your 20s and all that stuff, but usually you don't have kids and you know, those types of responsibilities, which are a totally different type of worry.
I mean, that's something that I feel I can speak to, being someone that was 37 years old and didn't have a kid and another.
Realize how carefree you were before?
Oh, yeah. Well, what I realize now is that, I mean, if to get my workouts in and diet in check, like it really takes a whole nother level. It takes planning no matter what, mm-hmm. no matter who you are, no matter how young you are. Having a child now, it's a whole nother level of planning for me to make sure that it's already hard enough for normal people to be consistent. If all you have to worry about is yourself, when you add in another person that now becomes as important or more important to you, that makes it really challenging schedule-wise to make it a priority.
Yeah, it takes a lot more discipline now to gain freedom.
Oh, yeah.
You know, like that, like I love discipline now because I know that that actually is providing me with more opportunities. But whereas before it was like, oh, I just have to put all this off and I got freedom.
Well, no, 100%, a great point. I'll give you a great example. You know, when you're in your 20s, maybe early 30s, and you don't have those kinds of responsibilities, and let's say it's Friday and you went to Vegas with your buddies and you partied till 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, you can sleep in Saturday morning. When you have kids, you don't. You go home from vacation and it's like, I gotta wake up early, gotta do all the stuff with the kids. And so for sure, generally speaking, one of the challenges of being over 40 with your workouts is you just have a busier schedule. That makes it more difficult to structure and do your workouts consistently. In fact, when you're younger, you might not even need to make a big deal about your schedule. But when you get older, your schedule is everything when it comes to your workouts. If it's not in your schedule, if it's not scheduled and planned, oftentimes it just doesn't happen, which can make it real difficult.
Yeah, I agree. You know, the next two are kind of the same thing. And Justin kind of quickly went over the, you know, ingrained muscle imbalances.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that also feeds right into the other one, which is chronic pain, which I think of all the things, of all the challenges at 40 and above that I see, for sure, dealing with chronic pain / muscle imbalances is probably the greatest challenge and probably the most important thing for you to put your attention towards when in the pursuit of overall health and fitness beyond 40.
Totally. Yeah. Now, ingrained meaning, if you have, let's say you've developed a muscle imbalance where you move a particular way or you have tight hips or a tight lower back and you're in your 20s or 30s, perhaps you've built this imbalance and cemented it for 5 or 10 years. Well, now you're 40. This is an imbalance that you've continued to strengthen and build for 20 years. It's harder to reverse that. It's a bit of a longer process to correct an imbalance that's been with somebody for a longer period of time than it is to work with an imbalance that was with somebody for a shorter period of time. In fact, it could be with somebody for so long that correcting it can feel quite strange. And I've seen this with people before where I train them and I correct imbalances, and when it starts to correct, I've had people tell me like, I feel like I'm sticking my chest out. That's a weird way to walk. Well, actually, that's good posture. It doesn't feel right because for the last 15 years, you've walked with your shoulders forward and didn't realize
that. Well, I mean, give the analogy I love to give when I'm trying to explain that to a client is, you know, to pick up a ball and throw it with your opposite hand or eat with your opposite hand. Like you've just have not trained your brain to work that pattern. If you would have been eating with your left hand your entire life, it would feel as natural as with your right. So that's exactly
another challenge I would run into with clients over the age of 40 was oftentimes they would come to me to hire me And they, the last time they had really worked out consistently would have been 15 to 20 years prior. So they'll come to me, they'll say, oh, you know, I'd like to lose weight, get in shape, whatever. And I'd say, okay, when was the last time that you were really consistent about working out for at least 6 months to a year? And they would typically say, oh, you know, when I was 30 or when I was 25, that's when I was really consistent. And then I had kids and all that stuff, and it all got in the way. And now, why is that a challenge? The challenge in that was because they remembered how their workouts were back then. They remembered how to move back then. They remembered their tolerance for intensity back then. And I have to get them to realize that they're a different person now.
Yeah, it's going to take a different sequence to get there now.
Yeah, like they would say to me, like, no, I used to work out, like, you know, every single day. This is the training session I used to do, or this is how hard I used to work out. And like, no, hold on.
Especially athletes, yeah.
Oh, I was just going to say, one of the hardest clients to train are, you know, I remember getting the 50-year-old or late 40s ex-NFL player, and, you know, they have been out of shape now for 20-plus years, and they want to train. And they a lot of times hire you because they want to get their ass kicked.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You know, they take me back to, you know, boot camp days of getting ready for the season, and that's how I need to get back in shape, because that's how they've done it for all of their fitness.
Through the pain.
Their entire fitness life was centered in sports. And so their training mentality comes from that, and now they're 50, and they remember how good, which is hard too, because they remember, they could connect how great a shape they were. Mm-hmm. Oh, I moved, I was strong, I look good, I want to be there, I know what it takes to get there. The reality is, it's totally different.
It is, and it's funny because your tolerance for exercise pain, when you've been doing that for a long time as an athlete, even if you stop working out for 20 or 30 years, for whatever reason, that becomes your gauge. Like when I would train ex-athletes, if I train them appropriately, they were always like, well, that's not hard enough. I'm not like crumbling. I'm like, okay, that was the pain tolerance, and that was acceptable when you were a professional athlete. You have to completely relearn how to listen to your body, because the way you listened to your body before is not going to work today.
Now, something else that we see a lot in advanced age, we're just going to call it advanced age.
It's not advanced age.
We're going to call it advanced age.
No, middle.
It feels
it's moderate.
It feels
middle
advanced.
Age.
Middle age, yeah.
Yeah, early, yeah, it's middle. Middle age.
Midlife crisis, come on. Get it right.
One of the most common things, though, that you'll get with somebody that's above 40 is hormone issues.
Yeah, they're more common.
Yeah.
Much more common.
And I think, again, real similar to some of the other things we're talking about, we always like to try and connect it to, oh, it's because I'm getting older. And it's like, well, it's less of that you're getting older, and it's more of all the other things that we're talking about that are probably causing that. The diet being off balance, the not weight training, your nutrition, you're not getting your sleep and stress. Mm-hmm. Like all these things are probably playing a bigger role on what's going hormonally with you than the fact that
lack of sun,
the number 40, right?
Yes. I've worked with so many clients, men and women, who've come to me in this age group or older, who, as part of our questionnaire, they do mention hormone stuff. They get tested, they come back and say, okay, testosterone's low, or my doctor or my specialist said estrogen dominance or whatever. And 9 out of 10 times, exercise and nutrition and sleep corrects it. 9 out of 10 times, in my experience. Mm. With men, it's almost 10 out of 10 times. I was very rare where I would get a man who had low testosterone levels that couldn't get significant improvements by changing their activity level, their diet, and their sleep. So the hormone changes you get when you age, this is especially true for men, because women do go through a natural, and it doesn't happen at 40. It can for some women, but women don't go through the big hormone change, menopause or perimenopause, typically until a little bit later. For a man who is appropriately active, good diet, good sleep, his testosterone levels will stay pretty damn high till the day he dies. So if you're 40 and you're inactive, diet's not good or whatever, and your testosterone's low, it's probably due to your lifestyle, and probably not due to the fact that your hormones are just low. But these are challenges, right? Because if you are over 40, the odds are you're dealing with recovery issues. You're not going to be able to recover as fast or get away with as much stupid stuff. Your schedule is a little busier, so when you work out, it needs to be effective. You're not in there to mess around or to do things that are inefficient. You may have muscle imbalances you need to correct that your 20-year-old self might not have to work with. And maybe you have some chronic pain you need to move around. These are some real challenges. That being said, being over 40, huge perks. There are massive perks to being over 40. One of the biggest ones is you tend to be more patient. Mm-hmm. You know, when I would get a 20-year-old client or a 30-year-old client, they want to get their results yesterday.
Yeah.
I want to do this yet. This is when I get my 40-year-old clients or 45-year-old clients, and I talk to them about how it's going to take time. We're going to correct muscle imbalances. You know what they always would say? Listen, don't worry about it. I just want to feel better. I'm going to do what you tell me. And it was a breath of fresh air. My most successful clients were typically in over this age group.
What I think that is? I think that you're older and you're wiser and you've started to connect how most things in life take time.
The best
things take a long time.
Right. And so I think at that age you start to piece that you've seen it enough times in your life that it makes sense that if this is going to be that great, it's probably going to take me some time to do this anyways, which reminds me of the second piece, which is the wisdom part. I feel like they kind of go hand in hand.
Oh, that experience and that wisdom is extremely valuable when you are trying to create a lifelong fitness and nutrition, lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
That makes a huge difference because the inexperienced person will tackle it head on and want to do everything all at once.
Yeah.
The person with experience, like you're saying, Adam, they've already experienced that. It took me a while to get used to having a kid. It took me a while to build my career. It takes a while to learn these things. I know this is going to take some time. I'm okay.
Yeah, this is too. I mean, hearing it from guys like us that have actually been in the gym for this long and then got to this point, it's like you have tried a lot of different methods and a lot of different exercises and protocols. And, it's about efficiency and it's about, getting that desired result, but like not having to put everything into it. And what does that even look like? And that's why we're always trying to voice, certain methods and ways to approach training where it's like you're going to get massive payout if you just do these small things.
Here's a great example of how experience with somebody over 40 makes a big difference. Let's say all things being equal, money, goals, everything's equal. The odds that a 25-year-old guy is going to hire a personal trainer are way lower than a 40-year-old guy, even if they had the same amount of money and everything, same goals, because the 40-year-old is experienced and they are experienced enough to know I'm going to hire somebody who knows what they're doing. The 25-year-old version of themselves, but I'm going to go in there and figure it out.
Well, most 40-year-old men and women understand investment better.
Right.
Period. Mm-hmm. They understand investment in the market, investment in retirement, investment in themselves a lot different than somebody who's 25, including myself. I remember at 25, your thoughts of investing and retirement and investment in yourself,
not the same.
That's too much to think about. I'm worried about today.
The biggest value or the biggest plus that comes from being over 40, again, we're speaking generally, and this is the one that I think contributes the most to success, is confidence. You're just more confident when you're older. You've got more experience. You're more comfortable in your body, a little bit less insecure. So what does that mean? That means that if you're a man, you're less likely to do something stupid in the gym because you need to lift tons of weight. 25-year-old version of me, if I'm in the gym and I'm learning a new exercise and I'm only using, 75 pounds, I might go, fuck, I don't want to. I'm going to go up to 100 pounds, even though I don't know how to do this exercise.
People are watching.
Yeah. Smarter version of me, older, wiser version of me. It's like, I got to learn this exercise. And I really don't give a shit what any of these people think.
Right.
What does that look for female clients? They don't care. I'm learning. I don't give a shit if anybody's looking at me, anybody cares, whatever. I want to take it my time. I want to do this the right way. I'm not trying to look a certain way right now, and I don't need to look a way tomorrow. Yeah. I just want to feel better and do this the right way. And that approach, that fundamental approach, is a massive contributor to long-term success, is that confidence and that security. Because the biggest mistakes you see made when people start a fitness routine typically come from insecurities, typically get driven by their their insecurities, and it drives diet and exercise in ways that just don't work.
Almost always. Anytime somebody has got issues about the body, body image issues, almost always will you see them make poor choices nutritionally and exercise-wise. Not knowing, though. right? Like that's part of why they make a bad choice is they don't realize it's a bad choice. They think they may be doing what's best for them, but because it's rooted in an insecurity, it causes them to make a quick or unrash decision, right? Where when you're a little bit older, wiser, less of that insecurities, you're a little more slow and patient to go, is that probably the best approach to do that? Or maybe I should listen to what Sal's saying and go a little bit slower and not worry about exactly how much I weigh or what I look like right now because I'm in this for the long game.
Totally, totally. I mean, I remember, and I was never that guy that really cared a lot about, people are watching me. I mean, I would say I probably cared more about how much weight I was lifting and people were watching, but I don't really care if I was looking a particular way. But I care even less now. Now as a 41-year-old man, when I'm in the gym, I'm in there for me. You want to look at me, I don't care. I'm in there for me. And I would notice this with my clients too. If I had a 25-year-old female client, it was like she had to have the right thing on, I had to look the right way.
Makeup was all thick.
Yeah, my 43-year-old female client was like, listen, I'm busy. I'm hiring you.
Yeah.
I want to do this the right way. I'm in my sweats. Teach me. I want to learn. Don't care about what people think. Show me how to exercise properly. That is very valuable, and I would never trade wisdom for youth, and I think people in this age group would agree with me for the most part. Here's another big plus, and this one's a big one. When you're over 40, you got more money.
Yeah.
And that makes a big difference.
Totally.
Because you can pay for programs that will instruct you, like, you know, like if you wanted to get like a MAPS program or a MAPS bundle, you're over 40, you have the expendable income, you can hire a trainer, you have the expendable income.
This just like reiterates the efficiency component of that. Now you have resources, so you can get even further, like, I'm going to do this the right way because I hired this coach, I bought this program, like I'm dialed in, and I'm not just like aimlessly like ramping up my intensity and like throwing the kitchen sink at what I'm trying to do.
Totally. You can hire massage therapists and chiropractors.
I was going to say, most of the clients that towards the end of my career of training clients I dealt with were, and these were some of my favorite, your high performing CEOs that, you know, I was one piece of all of everything. They would have the massage therapist already booked every single
week.
You're
one of their staff members.
Cairo. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They said, hey, again, older, wiser, understanding the value and investing in themselves. And hey, I'm going to go hire the best trainer. I'm going to go hire the best massage therapist. I'm going to go hire a nutritionist. I'm going to hire these people that will take care of that. That's one of the pluses of being older. More than likely, you have disposable income to be able to do something. It doesn't necessarily mean you will, but you're more likely to as you get older.
You can hire professionals, and you're more likely to have the wisdom to know that it's a good idea to do so.
Right.
All right. So let's talk about the things that, generally speaking, people over the age of 40 should focus on.
The five must-dos, I think.
Must-dos.
Yeah.
Absolute must-dos. These are the things. If you focus on these things, you will have your odds of a successful fitness program, the odds that you'll get to your goals and keep the progress and results that you get are going to be far higher if you follow the advice that we're about to give. And again, we've worked with, I'd say, over 70% of my clients were in this age group, mostly because of the expendable income.
Yeah.
I was not cheap, and I know you guys weren't.
Me
so,
either.
So that's the main reason why. So we've worked a lot with these people, and these are the things that we always focus on. Number one, form is everything. Mm-hmm. There is nothing more important than your form and technique when you exercise. By the way, form is everything for everybody when you work out.
Mm-hmm.
You just can't get away with not listening to this as you get older.
There's not as much wiggle room. You really do have to make sure your mechanics and everything, like posture is everything, especially as you get older. You want to make sure that, if you're moving in the right direction, like you're not going to put that added bit of stress on the joints that is unnecessary. Like you want to really focus it in on the muscles.
Yeah. Think of it this way. Okay. Let's look at the squat, a barbell squat. Barbell squat is a complex exercise. It's multi-joint, super effective exercise for the lower body, and just overall strengthens everything. One of the best exercises you could possibly do. When your form is good and you have good control and good stability and good mobility, a squat done properly is extremely safe. It's very, very safe. It's a natural human movement. Your risk of injury, doing everything right with good control, good stability. I mean, the only way you'd really hurt yourself would be a freak accident with all those things, like I talked about in that context, right? Now, a squat where you don't have control, stability, and mobility, or your form is off, your risk of injury goes up. And the more your form is off, the risk of injury is exponential. The more it's off, the greater the risk, to the point where you're guaranteed an injury if your form is off enough. Now, that exponential growth of risk of injury is steeper when you're over 40 than when you're 20.
Well, and this is why you hear crazy advice out there. Like, I'll read blogs and things from doctors that are like making sure like people refrain from doing deadlifts or refrain from doing backloaded squats. And they put all this red tape over because, you know, they're making the case for you getting hurt doing this type of an exercise, where really it's about the form has to be like damn near perfect for you to pull it off at this point.
Well, this is, we got tagged, I think all three of us got tagged in a Instagram post just about 2 days ago. And it was a professional athlete trainer who was making the case that he never squats or deadlifts bilaterally, and that he does everything unilateral, right? So, and they were tagging us, obviously, to see if we were going to stir up shit and argue with it. And I said, context matters, and I can make a case for this. Like, absolutely, if I have a client who is battling tons of chronic pain and has tons of muscle imbalances, I'm first going to probably be spending most of my time in the gym with them addressing those imbalances. And then maybe the first thing I do progress them to are things like lunges, Bulgarian split squats, single leg deadlift, and stuff like that, first to really reinforce their stability and mobility before I start to progress them in strength. So yeah, absolutely, there's a case for not squatting right away. But to Sal's point, if you've got great form and technique in your squat, it's perfectly safe. If it's not, backing back and saying, okay, well, maybe we'll do things like Bulgarian split squats, lunges, and replace that for now with the ideal goal of making it to the squat.
It may take some time. It may take that time to really reestablish that. Like, you have support, you have control over your joints like you should. So yeah, like I totally agree. You have to make sure you are in a place where everything is accounted for and you have good form and all that before really just jumping right back into what you used to be able to do.
Right. So again, another example, use squats again. You have two people doing the squat, barbell squat, both one person mid-20s or 30, the other one, you know, 45 years old, and they're doing the squats, and in one of the reps, their weight shifts a little bit to the right, so they have to correct by straightening the bar out. Okay, the odds that the 45-year-old, that'll result in an injury are higher than it is in the 25-year-old, for all the reasons that we listed before, the more ingrained muscle imbalances, the odds that they've had injuries in the past. So those all add up, and so when the form is off a little bit, the risk is higher typically for the older person than it is for the younger person. Because of that risk, form, again, it's the most important thing regardless of your age, but it's far more important when you get older because of exactly what we're talking about. Your risk of injury goes up quite a bit. Now, here's the other side of this. Good form is going to give you faster results anyways. This is the good part about this. Because if sometimes people think that sacrificing form will get them there faster, that is a myth. Sacrificing form will get you there slower, even if you don't hurt yourself. Mm-hmm. Good form gets you better and faster results anyway. So there really is no drawback to realizing that form is everything.
Not to mention, this is also one of the first ways you start to see you alleviate the chronic pain. All of a sudden, I get a client who had chronic low back pain or hip pain. We mobilize them. We start teaching perfect, great form with squats, good full range of motion, good control. And they get to a place within that, even if it's weak-ass weight, not even heavy weight, just working towards getting to a really beautiful squat. Them focusing on that, all of a sudden the feedback you'd start getting as a coach is, oh my God, you know what I noticed? My low back doesn't bother me. Oh, my hips don't bother me anymore, because we worked towards that.
Oh, totally. Traditional resistance training exercises done properly are the best mobility movements you'll find anywhere. It's true. Traditional resistance training exercises. If you can do a proper deadlift with good form, stability, control, and mobility, if you could do a proper barbell squat, overhead press, row, bench press, if you could do all of these exercises properly and you just keep doing them properly and make sure you perfect your form, those are the simplest, most easiest, basic, and also most effective ways of maintaining mobility long term.
Some of my clients, you know, in this sort of age range, like, that would ask me, like, why, like, they didn't understand why I wasn't so focused on the rep count, you know, quite as much as I was previously. And really, it's about the intention of every single rep. Like, mm-hmm. I want to see you, like, really focusing in on what has to take place in order to kind of, you know, make sure everything, like, joint wise is working properly and all the mechanics are established and you're bracing and, like, all these things, like, you're really focusing in. You get so much more payoff from that alone. But even now, that's such a great way to, you know, protect yourself.
Well, you saying that also reminds me of what I think is for sure one of the most important, which is the importance of priming.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, it's important for all ages. It becomes necessary once you get to this point.
It makes number one, what we just talked about, possible.
Yes. Yes.
If form is everything, then that means when you go into an exercise, you want to have good form. That's what priming does. Proper priming sets you up so that you go into your exercise and right away you have good control, stability, mobility, and form. Not doing proper priming, your odds of doing that are much lower. And priming is quite individual from person to person. If I'm doing squats, for example, and my issue is my ankle mobility, then doing ankle mobility priming before my squats means when I go into my squats, my form is going to look a lot better. It's going to feel a lot better. Same thing with thoracic mobility, or, you know, if you're somebody that has low back pain or shoulder pain, priming before you do these exercises means you're going to be able to do them the right way. You could get away with not warming up sometimes, but as you get older, you can't get away with it nearly as much. You just can't, again, for all the reasons that we talked about earlier. Now, luckily, people over 40 are smarter, and I typically don't have to convince them that this is important like I do with my 25-year-old clients, where I have to sit them down. But why? I just jump into it, and it feels good, and it's not a problem. You know, talking to my older clients, as soon as I would bring this up, they would say, oh, no. And if I didn't bring it up, well, they would tell me.
Yeah, this is one of those where you actually can sell. Like, if you're a personal trainer, you could sell somebody on your training so much through these priming sessions. And you could show them individually how you can help to alleviate pain by just doing these things and making a ritual out of it. And not to mention, like, the ritual is so individualized. So if there's, like, certain issues that I'm facing, like, my shoulders are protracting constantly, I'm in this forward position, and I'm able to now, like, constantly pull myself back, retract my shoulders, and get that external rotation. And, man, that frees everything. I feel great. Like, my pain has been, like, you know, lowered. So it's not hard to sell people on that idea.
Well, I remember when we wrote Prime, you know, we also included the fortification sessions, and, you know, I would have to say probably 50% is a good guess for me of the clients that I would have to just kind of live there for the first.
Oh, that's their workouts.
Yeah, for the first month or two. So this is, you know, we're right now we're talking about priming the body, like, before you go into a squat or before you go into your workout. But, you know, when we're talking about above 40, there was probably a half of my clients that age and above spent a majority of their time just in the fortification sessions. And just we had the imbalances that we had going on, the chronic pain that we had was such an issue that a majority of the workout was just to correct all that. So it's basically, you know, our fortification sessions, think of them like corrective training for imbalances. And that's what it looks like. And this is also, again, why this part is so important, because if you're going to get to the form of a squat and how it's so beneficial, you first got to do the prerequisites, which is this piece. And when you're getting 40 and above, this becomes mandatory. It's one of those things, again, you can get away with in your 20s, just get right into your workout, or, oh, maybe my form's not the greatest, I'll figure it out, I'll learn. No, when you're starting in the game in 40 and above, or it's been years and years since you've been lifting and you're getting back into it at 40, this area, priming, fortification, yes, like, this is extremely important.
Yeah, but I think too, like, this was the appeal of yoga, and this is why, like, yoga really took off. It's like a way for people to move their body in ways where it just makes it feel good again. And, you know, there's a way to be a little bit more specific with that, and also then apply that in to your regular workouts so you're still getting the benefits of weight training on top of it.
Well, somebody may, you know, you may be wondering, what's the difference between priming and warming up? Okay. Warming up is very general. Priming is far more specific. Warming up is trying to prevent injury. Priming prevents injury better and also makes your body progress faster. You get better, faster results. Just like we did with form, just like I said with form, the irony of, you know, you need to prime is priming will get you better results also. So even if you're listening and you're like, I don't need to prime or whatever, fine. You might not hurt yourself, but you're still going to reduce the quality of your results and maybe even the speed of your results, because being able to connect to your muscles and to movements right out the gates when you do your workout, that adds up. And you'll progress faster or slower depending on whether or not you're doing that or not. So priming, essential for over 40, but besides the fact that it prevents injury and makes you feel better, it also gives you better, faster results. So do them. Absolutely. Here's the next one. And this one, I think people over 40, in my experience, are much better at this.
Yeah, ties in with the wisdom thing.
Yes, than people who are younger. And this is something I like to hammer home, which is listen to your body. Pay very close attention to your body. And if you're doing an exercise or a movement or you're eating in a particular way and it doesn't feel right, then you should probably heed that, you know, listen to that signal. I've said this before on the podcast, regardless of all the advice that we give on the show on Mind Pump, there is no better coach than your own body. And so even if I say to you on the podcast, squats are the best exercise known to man, and no matter what, squats don't feel good to you, don't do them. Maybe try to get yourself to a point where you can do them, but don't do them. Listen to your body. If you feel really super tired from your workout, if it's affecting your sleep, if you're like, hey, I thought I was supposed to feel better while working out and yet I feel worse, listen to your body. Not doing so is going to result in your body getting signals getting louder. You know, today it might be sore, achy muscles. Tomorrow it may actually be an injury. And I have story after story of people who failed to listen to their body. It's like, in fact, if you're listening right now and you have a chronic, if you have an injury, I bet you can think back to how long you were ignoring the signals telling you that you were about to hurt yourself.
Right.
That's typically, yeah.
At this point, a pattern. Yeah, all those like signs and signals, they come to fruition. And so it's like, yeah, the sooner you address those, obviously, like you get on top of it, the better you're going to be. And what we were going to talk about too is like maxing out, right? Like in terms of like really challenging yourself. Like there's a point in a time for that, but I think in the over 40 kind of category, like, is there really a need to challenge yourself on that level?
No, there's not. And before we get into maxing out, I think the you know, more on the listening to your body, one of the things I think that you start to get better as you get older too is how sore you feel the next day, and understanding that you didn't need to be that sore to have had an effective workout.
And if anything, it took away.
Right.
It was detrimental.
And, yeah. And you know, I think I've said this on this show probably 100+ times now that, you know, our goal is always to do the least amount as possible to elicit the most amount of change. And so I really try to drive home with my, you know, 40+ and all clients for that matter, that, you know, if you are listening to your body and you feel so sore the next day, it's impeding the way you walk. It's impeding the way you move. It's definitely impeding into your next workout. Then we overreached. We stretched ourselves more than we needed to get the maximum results. You could have scaled that way back and still reaped incredible benefits from the workout.
Or more benefits. That's
right,
the thing. A lot of people need to realize that, right? That it becomes detrimental to cause that much damage to your body. So you got to listen. But back to the injury, you know, I used to love having this conversation with potential clients. They would come in and I'd ask them, you know, questions about their history and whatnot, and, you know, pain. And they'd say, oh, I hurt my shoulder. I had a shoulder injury. And I'd say, okay, before your shoulder got hurt, was it bothering you? And they'd say, well, yeah, it did kind of hurt a little bit. And it would bother me when I would do this, and it would bother me when I'd do that. And I'd say, oh, how long did that happen for? Oh, for years, my shoulder was a little off, and then finally I hurt myself. I'd say, okay, those were all signals. Your body was talking to you. You just didn't listen, and you didn't fix it, and then it finally got hurt. Moving forward, we are going to listen to your body. That means if we do an exercise and tomorrow you don't feel muscle soreness, but you feel joint pain or stiffness. You're going to tell me, hey, Sal, yesterday's workout, I noticed I woke up in the morning and my elbows hurt. Is my elbow supposed to hurt? I'm like, no. The triceps maybe, but not your elbows. Now I'm going to change your workout a little bit to address that. That's what listening to your body really means. Don't just hammer through because no pain, no gain. That's not how it works. Pay attention to your body. Adjust your workouts accordingly. That's such a profound and impactful thing to address.
Shameless plug here, but I mean, this is how we wrote all these programs. Like, someone listening right now is going like, okay, so you have elbow pain. What do you do then, Sal? Well, this is why we created MAPS Prime Pro, is to help guide somebody who doesn't have a coach or can't afford to have a trainer that's telling them every time they have to modify like that. And this is how you use that program. This is not a standalone program that most people will just follow every single day. It's something that you have in your tool bag that, oh shit, I'm training this way and now my knees are bothering my hips or something. And then you go into Prime Pro and you go to the test section that's addressing the joint that you have an issue in, and it's going to give you exercises that you should perform before and after you work out to help prevent that. So, you know, when we wrote a lot of these programs, we were thinking just like coaches and trainers. When we have a situation where we have to call an audible, what will we do? Well, how do we give that to the general population? That's an example on how you use Prime Pro when you run into issues like that, because that's very common. Mm-hmm. It's common for everybody. It's really common when you're above 40 that you're going to run into these things. You're following a great program, even if it's a MAPS program, it's going great for you. All of a sudden, you're just getting chronic hip pain, or you're getting like knee pain. And, you know, the first thing you want to do is stop doing the exercises. Well, the better thing for you to do is to figure out, get to the root cause of what that is. Well, how does the average person do that?
Totally.
You use tools like that.
But that all starts with listening, right? And not ignoring your body. So right. It's the opposite of listening to your body, is ignoring your body. Don't do that. Okay, so Justin, you brought something up that I thought is very, very
jumped the gun on that.
Very, no, that's great advice. It's skip maxing out. There's no need to test yourself. Now, I know there is some value in testing your performance, and it's more of a mental and emotional value. Sometimes pushing yourself to a limit, regardless of age, is a great way to test your mental capacity or emotional capacity to give you that fire. I get that. But you're older, you're more wise, and the risk is much higher. My advice is largely skip that. In fact, and you're more secure. You probably don't even need to do this as much. Or if you're not, think twice before you do. So what does that mean? There's no need to go to the gym and see how much you can bench or how much you can squat. There's no need for you to go and run and see how far you can run.
Or how fast.
Do your workouts and you're challenging yourself. Remember, workouts have to be challenging for them to be effective. That's always a part of exercise. Otherwise, your body doesn't adapt. But it's the maxing out and testing yourself that you don't need to do anymore. That's a surefire way. At some point, by the way, I'm going to make this statement and I'll stand by it. If you max out a lot and test yourself a lot, it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when the injury is going to happen.
Yeah.
You are going to hurt yourself.
I saw such a clear example of this between my dad and his best friend. They're both named Steve. And his friend, like, throughout the years he's just done very like moderate to maybe, I mean, he did challenging workouts, but he would always stop before it was, you know, he put too much into it to where like he knew tomorrow he was going to like do the next workout. And so he was just super, super consistent over the years. And he's in incredible shape for his 70s. Mm-hmm. And it's this attitude of, this is a constant thing. Mm-hmm. And I'm just going to keep this a part of my everyday activities. And it's not like I'm going to blast myself because, you know, it's very ego driven kind of, you know, when I'm going to max out, like what else? I'm just trying to test myself and see where I stand versus like, I'm in this for the long game.
Well, I blame this on our space. We've done lots of research and studies of support going to failure and intensity being such an important variable. And it is by itself, but when you compare it to smart, consistent training,
it doesn't come close.
And even in workout by workout, you're splitting hairs on how much better that extra rep was, and that's a lot of the messaging in our space, is beast mode, all out, you know, grinding, push, you know, it's all this motivation hype. And part of why I think I've always hated it as a trainer and a coach, because I've trained so many normal, average day people that are not in the fitness space, and that message gets misconstrued, and that's normally when injury happens. They think that I got to give it my all. I got it. The just like what we see in Biggest Loser right now. Sal, you brought up a point about knowing somebody that's behind the scenes saying that, you know, they don't really push that hard. That's only the little clips to show that. That makes me even more mad about the show, because what they're doing
emphasizing is
false advertising.
Right, exactly. They're putting emphasis on the push and grind and you know, making them throw up, even if it's not a reality of what they're doing most of the time. Like, that's terrible. It's terrible messaging to the majority, because most people see that, and then they, as soon as they decide their new way of life and they're going to be going back to the gym, that's the way they apply it. And that couldn't be further from the truth as far as the best way to be training, especially being north of 40 years
old. Totally. This is, so I'm going to start training my dad pretty soon on a semi-consistent basis. And this is one of the main reasons why. My dad has he's got a very competitive background. He's got a competitive attitude. And his attitude is, when I go work out, if I can't go hard, then I'm wasting my time. If I'm not going to go and use the whole stack and see how strong I am,
right,
then it's a waste of time. And so I have, you know, right now he's dealing with some major back pain, some really, really back. It was pretty debilitating. I've been going over to his house and stretching him. Can't even do anything else with him right now, just taking him through stretches. And I told him, as soon as this pain is better, because it will get better at some point, I'm going to train you, because I know you don't know how to work out. You go in the gym and you think, you got to go hard, otherwise it's a waste of time. I need to completely change his paradigm and understanding of exercise. And this is a big one. It's not about, look, unless if you're a power lifter and you're a competitor, okay, it makes perfect sense. You need to know where you stand. You're competing against other people. But the vast majority of you listening, or the vast majority of people that go to work out, never compete in anything.
Yeah.
There is no reason for you to max out, aside from the mental and emotional satisfaction of knowing that you accomplished something. But now that you're over 40, you probably don't. I mean, do you really need to do that like you did before? I don't think your ego needs
it. You don't need
much.
These competitions either. No, don't need to sign up for all these things to get you to a place you really want to be. You just need to just keep doing little bits all the time.
Well, there's ways to test yourself or push yourself without maxing out.
Yeah, to be smart.
I mean, most good programming is going to have, you know, 5 rep range and above in it. Very few programs, unless you're doing a powerlifting specific program, is going to recommend singles, doubles, or triples. But hey, you know, if you've been training 5x5 type of training and you've gotten really strong and you're like, man, I want to see if I can lift a little bit more. Well, put a little bit more on the bar and then stop short 3. Or 2.
Right, right.
You know, there's no reason to try and find your absolute limit of what you can load your back with.
No, here's what I like to do, right? I have a mental understanding of about 85 to 90% of my effort. So I know what that feels like, cuz I've been working out for a while. I can move within that range and add weight. I just don't go above it. In other words, if I lifted, you know, 200 pounds and that was 90% intensity, and I try it this week and 200 pounds felt like 80% intensity, I'll add weight, but I won't go up to 100% intensity. I'm not going to go up to maxing out, because, again, the risk of injury is nowhere near worth the whatever you're going to get from testing yourself and maxing out. So skip that part. All right, here's the last one, and I think this one is important, just like all of them are important for everybody, but it's especially important and valuable for people over the age of 40, and that is to place your health over your performance in terms of priorities, or your mobility over strength is another way to put it. Health is far more important than how well you can perform, how strong you are, how fast you can move, because focusing on your health is going to take you to the finish line at the very end of this game we call life. Focusing on performance, at some point your body's going to stop you, and it's going to stop you hard. And if you don't believe me, just look at the highest level athletes that exist, like a professional athletes, and you can see how well they do typically after they retire. And oftentimes they're riddled with pain and injuries and things that prevent them from doing a lot of awesome things. But if you make your focus your health, if I go to the gym and I eat in a way to really nourish and feed and fuel my body to feel good, then I'm going to stop when I decide to stop. My body's not going to tell me to stop.
Well, this is also one of the safest and smartest ways to prevent injury, right? It's just having this mentality. I think of even something like I'm going through personally right myself. Like a 2020 goal for me is to get back to playing basketball. Since I tore my Achilles, I haven't played ball. Now, the young mind of mine wants to just like grab the ball, get back on the court, run some games, let myself naturally get back in the shape of that, start training some explosive type movements. But instead, like, I know I'm doing all the boring, tedious type of work to build up to that because I'm prioritizing my overall health more than my performance.
Totally.
Like, as much as I want to get on the court and start just getting better and like, oh, throw myself in it, I know that the age that I'm at now and that because of, you know, torn ACL, MCL and a torn Achilles and, you know, creeping up on 40 years old, that if I do that, I'm at such a higher risk of potentially injuring myself even longer. So just keeping the mindset of healthy joints, being healthy mobility-wise, that comes first, then I'll build the performance piece on top of
totally.
It.
Totally. Now, again, here's the wonderful kind of beautiful irony of all of this, right? Form is everything. Prime your body. Listen to your body. Skip maxing out. Prioritize health over performance. Not only are these things that are going to give you longevity with your fitness, your fitness lifestyle, but they're also going to get you better results.
A healthy body performs better.
That's it.
At the end of the day, I mean, that's one of those things. I think people just forget that, and they want to, challenge and press their body to the limits of whatever they can, wherever they can go with it. But, realizing that, rest and feeding your body appropriately and also like backing off weights gives you even more performance to then, fuel back into those workouts and those sporting events and all those other things you're trying to do.
Now, and along those lines, this is 100% true. My best performing clients, I'm talking about clients that did some of the most awesome everyday clients. I'm not talking about my athletes. I'm just talking about average people. The clients that did the most incredible transformations, the clients that got really strong and just were impressive, the ones that were doing triathlons and runs that were blowing people's minds, the ones that got shredded and did so the right way, they were all my over 40 clients. Some of my best performers, if I had to take generally just a lot of people and rate their performance, my over 40 clients were the ones that crushed. That before and after picture that is somewhere on Doug's Instagram of Doug going from overweight to shredded, he was in his 40s when that happened, and he accomplished the best fitness of his life. Never had a six-pack his entire life. Never was able to deadlift 400 pounds, which was a tremendous feat for somebody his size. He did so in his late 40s. And it's because he did everything right and he had the wisdom and the money to hire a good trainer. And it all worked out.
Shameless plug.
And it all worked out exceptionally well. And if you're over 40 yourself and you want to follow a good, first off, hiring a trainer is the best possible thing you can do. Hire a good trainer, someone who's experienced, who knows what they're doing. That's all the best thing you could do. But if you want to do something a little less expensive, the best program, I think, for people in this age group who have a little bit of experience working out would be MAPS Anabolic, hands down. And you could do 2 days a week in the gym or 3 days a week in the gym as the program is laid out.
I'm going to challenge that a little bit, just that I think that if you're going to have Anabolic, you have to have Prime and Prime Pro.
Throw them on there.
Yeah, just because that makes sure that it encompasses anybody over 40. If you're in good shape, no chronic pain, feel pretty good as far as your form and technique goes as a 40-year-old, then I could say just go Anabolic, you'll be just fine. But if you've got chronic pain, you have tight muscles, you know that your form may not be the best, you absolutely, in my opinion, have to have Prime and Prime Pro to complement that if you really care longevity-wise. If you really care about setting this up the right way long-term, I think those have to go with that.
Well, we actually have an over 40 bundle that includes MAPS Anabolic and MAPS Prime and MAPS Anywhere, which is good for travel and stuff because of the time that we tend to find with professionals in the age group. So that works out really well. We also have free resources. So if you're listening and you just want more information, you don't want to pay anything for it, we have really, really good resources and guides that we wrote that help with fat loss and muscle building. We have exercise-specific guides. Like we have one that teaches you how to get a better squat. We have guides for personal trainers. You can find all of those free resources at mindpumpfree.com. You can also find the three of us on Instagram. You can find Justin at Mind Pump Justin. You can find me at Mind Pump Sal, and Adam at Mind Pump Adam.